Hi and welcome to this Facebook Live discussion at The Wire with Manoj Mitta, author of The Fiction of Fact-Finding. This is arguably one of the most comprehensive books to emerge out of the 2002 Gujarat massacres, and I say that as somebody who wrote or edited one of the first books, but Manoj Mitta's book is unique because it comes at the fag end of a long process of investigation and prosecution, and essentially is a critique of the special investigation team's efforts in probing the Gujarat violence in general, and in particular, the manner in which it discharged its duty or the task of ascertaining whether the then Chief Minister of the Gujarat, Narendra Modi, along with 60 plus other senior political and state officials had a case to answer for when it came to their alleged complicity in the 2002 violence. But we are here to discuss, Manoj, not so much the, not directly the SIT of the book. I just wanted to flag this book for our readers to establish that we are talking to somebody who's followed these cases closely. The immediate peg for our discussion, of course, is the testimony that Amit Shah gave, the BJP president, gave in the trial court for the Naroda Gam massacre case in Ahmedabad yesterday. Mm-hmm. This was testimony that he was asked to give as a defense witness for Maya Kodnani, who at the time of the 2002 massacre was simply a BJP leader. She was elevated to cabinet by Narendra Modi a few years later, even though there were allegations over the previous 5 years of her involvement in Naroda Patia, for which she's since been convicted, and Naroda Gam. Mm-hmm. And Mr. Modi took her in after she was convicted by the trial court in the Naroda Patia massacre for playing a central role in directing the mobs and being part of the conspiracy to massacre perhaps 4 or 5 dozen people. She then quit. She went to jail. She's out on bail right now. And the issue at hand is her involvement or her alleged involvement in the Naroda Gam case. Mm-hmm. She had said and complained to the court that she had been unable to reach Amit Shah to come to court as a witness. So finally, Shah was summoned and Shah appeared. And there he said, or he corroborated her claim, that at two moments in the morning, around 8 to half past 8 and around 11 o'clock in the morning, when the some eyewitnesses or the prosecution says she was at Naroda Gam or perhaps involved at a different location, Amit Shah corroborated her claim that she was in the first instance at the assembly building and in the second instance in hospital with her. So let's start by giving us your assessment as a journalist, as somebody with legal training also, the significance of Shah's testimony in the context of what she has been saying and in the context of the Naroda Gam case itself.
As you said, this is something that happened rather belatedly, and since it is in the run-up to the Gujarat elections, it raised eyebrows, it triggered the speculation whether this is something that's going to have a major political impact. I wouldn't go into any of that, but to suggest that this is all something that provides Maya Kodnani an alibi would be a little bit of a misreading, because as you said, what Amit Shah did was a corroboration of her claim that she was present at these two places on the morning of February 28, 2002. But it so happens that it's also a corroboration of what the prosecution said about her. This was a matter of record. This is there even in that SIT report on Zakia Jafri's okay. complaint against Modi and others, that this was the sequence of events. On 27th, after the Godhra incident, the bodies were brought from Godhra. Early in the morning, they arrived in Ahmedabad. They were taken to this Sola Civil Hospital.
Right.
And the interesting thing is, that there were as many as 54 bodies that were brought, because 4 bodies were taken by the relatives of those deceased persons in Godhra itself. Mm-hmm. And 54 bodies were brought here, not by the police, at least not officially. On record, it is the VHP which was given custody. It is a particular leader called Jaydeep Patel,
yeah,
who was given custody. There was a letter to that effect from the Godhra district administration handing over custody to this man. And this was after VHP had already declared a band. They were up in arms. A band which is, strictly speaking, not legal, but the government very evidently, on record it can be seen, went out of its way to help the cause of those who had called for band. They were given the satisfaction of getting possession of these bodies when, as per the law, it is only the next of kin. It's a very strict rule of law that you can't give the body of somebody to anybody who claims to be associated with them, right, with those bodies. So it's only the next of kin who should have been given. But they made that very significant deviation. And it was on the basis of that letter that, a district official, Nalwaya, Mamlatdar of Godhra, Mahendra Nalwaya, who gave to this Jaydeep Patel. It was on the basis of that letter that Sola Civil Hospital took possession of these bodies, because you need documentation. I mean, there should be some official communication on the basis of which you take possession of these bodies. Now, Amit Shah said that he was there at the hospital for a while because, among other things, post-mortem was being conducted. There is a little inaccurate. Post-mortem was done in Godhra itself, right on the platform of the Godhra railway station. What was holding up these bodies in Sola Civil Hospital for a while was the process of identification, that many bodies could not be identified. As many as 19 out of those 54 bodies ultimately could not be identified
at all.
At all.
Okay.
And they were therefore cremated and disposed of as unidentified bodies, right? So to say that they were all VHP members would be misleading, because even among those who were identified were not all VHP members. And for all we know, some of the unidentified persons might not even have been Hindus. I mean, this is a matter of speculation. The fact that they remain unidentified leaves open that possibility, right? But anyway, be that as it may, it was the process of identification that was holding up the release of those bodies. And it was during that time that a big mob had collected there. And that is what this man was referring to. And it's all a matter of record. In their testimonies before the SIT, whether it is Maya Kodnani or Amit Shah, had already said this. Nothing really hinges on the fact that she was there at some point, at around 11:30. That is what this man testifies, and that is what broadly corroborates what the prosecution, the SIT also said, right, in Sola Civil Hospital. And the fact that early in the morning at 8:30, there was a special session of the assembly called to pass a condolence motion was also a matter of record. It is reasonable to conceive that all the BJP MLAs, especially those who are from Ahmedabad city itself, as Maya Kodnani herself was,
would be present there.
And these two localities, Naroda Patia and Naroda Gam, happened to fall in her constituency, right? And she was a practicing doctor, a gynecologist, and so she was, these are her parts of the town. So now the question is, what happened between these two points of time? You know, between 8:30 and 9, yes, she was in the assembly, as were so many other MLAs. And Shah testifies that he did notice her there, fair enough. No problem with that. And then he says he saw her next in the hospital around 11:30. Now that does not preclude the possibility of what several eyewitnesses said in the Naroda Patia case, as also in the Naroda Gam case, that they saw her in Naroda area. They saw her coming in her vehicle and supplying swords, instigating mobs, talking with...
And they saw this happening around 9:30 or so,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, they saw her during that time. Yes. You know,
In between these two events where Shah corroborates that she was present.
So, now, to somebody who does not have any idea of what is already known, what is already a matter of record, it might seem that this man is, you know, at this belated stage in the run-up to the Gujarat elections, providing an alibi to her. But, you know, this is, firstly, he's not saying anything new. Secondly, whatever he said, it does not rule out, does not discredit in any way, put a question mark in any way on the eyewitness testimonies that are there in both these cases.
Correct. Okay. So, to that extent, this is really...
perception, correct. Optics.
Correct.
What I find significant, though, is the case itself. See, this case is not significant only because Maya Kodnani is implicated. As you know...
And the actual death toll at Narodagam is 4 or 5 people compared to...
11
people compared to 60-plus at Narodapatya.
No, Narodapatya is 96.
96, okay.
That was the biggest massacre
single
that
incident,
took place.
Yes.
Right? And all these... Gulbarg Society was the first massacre. That took place in the afternoon. That was 69. And Narodapatya, the violence began in the morning, towards the evening, when it was found that near a water tank, many bodies, some 40-50 bodies were recovered from that particular place, and it all happened, said to have happened towards the evening, right? So it's something that happened through the day.
Right.
Similarly, in Narodagam also, it dragged on. It's not any one. Unlike in, say, those two incidents, where, you know, Gulbarg Society or Narodapatya, there was no one big massacre. It happened over a period in Narodagam, which is in the vicinity of Narodapatya. And now, what is significant of Narodagam is not merely the fact that, Maya Kodnani is implicated in it, because she was already implicated in Narodapatya. And not only was she implicated, she was also convicted.
Correct.
And that was a historic happening for those of us who have been tracking communal violence, because never has there been an instance in the history of independent India of a political leader being convicted. So that was indeed a very significant event. Now, she was, while being convicted, she was called the kingpin of the massacre there. And she was given as many as 28 years of sentence.
Right. You
know? Now, so this, if she is convicted in this, this would be the second case, right? So, now, therefore, it's not so significant in itself. So what is more significant about Narodagam is that it also implicates an important leader of the Sangh Parivar, a VHP leader,
Jaydeep
who we
Patel.
just now discussed, Jaydeep Patel. Why is he so important? Because, you know, like in the case of Maya Kodnani, what was noticed was that there was extensive telephone evidence, call data records, which showed that this man was in touch with several police officials. He was also in touch with Sanjay Bhavsar, who was in the Chief Minister's office, one of the private secretaries or in the personal staff of Modi. Now, he was in touch with these people when he was on his way to Godhra the previous day. And it was because he was in touch with them, he had enough clout to pull off such a letter that he...
Of taking custody of
such a sensitive matter. Such a huge crime takes place, and all the bodies are officially, formally, on record, handed over to him. Now, this is a letter that has never been denied. It is part of record. Now, it's a basis on which some inquiries were also conducted, and all sorts of very strange responses it elicited. Modi said that I do not remember seeing him at the meeting that was held in Godhra on the evening of 27th at the collectorate. But very interestingly, very significantly, Jayanti Ravi, the collector, said in her testimony to the SIT that Jaydi Patel was very much there in that meeting where the decision to send the bodies to Ahmedabad the very next morning was taken, where she corroborates Modi is in the claim that they didn't decide to give the bodies to Jaydi Patel because that was, as I said earlier, patently against the law. They couldn't admit that. So what they instead said was that this Mahendra Nalwaya, that Mamlatdar, that junior district official, gave this letter on his own, right? Mm. Now, this is hard to believe on the face of it, and it's all the more difficult to believe because Jayanti Ravi admits that she met this man again late in the night before the bodies were
sent off
from Godhra. That she admits that she met this man. So we are being asked to believe that while she met this Patel, while the bodies were being sent off from Godhra, she was unaware of this letter that was given by her administration to this man.
Yeah.
You know, that is such a crucial basis on which the bodies were being transferred.
Right.
You can't just decide verbally and transfer, because now there's a legal matter, there's an FIR, and it's not a murder of one or two persons, it's 58 people.
Yeah.
On that day it was 58, one more died a couple of days later, so it became 59. A crime of that magnitude, so you don't casually send something.
Yeah.
This whole basis on which this transfer took place, it is very important to recall, to remember that the transfer of bodies took place from Godhra to Ahmedabad in these very dubious circumstances.
And this establishes
very telltale circumstances.
And to your mind, this is significant because it establishes the clout of Jaydi Patel in the entire sequence of events.
And it establishes how the government was being very soft on the people who were organizing this protest, this
bandh. Yeah.
And mobilizing these mobs. And sure enough, out of those 54 bodies that were there at Sola Civil Hospital, 10 of them were taken to some in a big procession.
Correct.
To a crematorium close to this Naroda Patia area. And eyewitness accounts and contemporary reports of the media and others say that this was the source of that trouble. Right. This is when people were mobilized, all sorts of very
incendiary.
Now, this man, Jaydi Patel, was there was this kind of call data record that was available against him. Now, significantly, this call data record did not come into being in the routine course when anything like this happens. For instance, just a few months before Godhra incident took place, there was this parliament attack case in Delhi, right? Now, that was cracked on the basis of this call data records, right? But somehow, the Modi administration, despite his reputation of being very strong and law and order issues, and when I say Modi administration, I don't mean only the chief minister. The home minister also happened to be Modi, right? In spite of his presence in the political leadership of that state, somehow it did not occur to the Gujarat police to, as a matter of course, look at the call data record evidence. It was left to a whistleblower called Rahul Sharma, who happened to be, abruptly transferred out of his district because he was...
he was in Bhavnagar?
Right, Bhavnagar.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So he was doing a very good job of...
One of the few policemen who actually upheld the law during those difficult days.
Bhavnagar, Surat.
Yes.
There were some districts like that where the police officers were very
efficient
and very firm in
controlling the violence,
right? So he was within a few days of that, he was transferred to Ahmedabad and he came to be associated with the investigation of Naroda Patia and Gulbarg Society. So he said, given his background in IIT, but even otherwise, as I said, it's a logical thing to do, right? So he asked for records from the two
telecom companies,
and that's how it came into being. But even at that stage, now soon after that, he was again transferred out of that place. So no action was taken on this call data record. Then he brings it up two years later before Nanavati Commission in 2004, right? And that is when, because he brought it up and put it on record, that is when it becomes public. Indian Express carried a series of stories giving details. Now, the most important revelation made by the call data record was about Maya Kodnani and Jaideep Patel, about the kind of calls they were making during that very significant period, 27th, 28th, and what it tells us about what was going on, their complicity, high-level complicity between the political leaders and the officials and all that, right, leading to this kind of violence. Yet, no action was again taken because the matter, if you recall, was still firmly in the control of Gujarat police. It was only later when the Supreme Court handed over these very significant cases, you know, after they tried Gujarat system, legal system, to make amends with Best Bakery and with the gang rape case of Bilkis Banu, when both those didn't work and they had to take remedial action by transferring them out.
Yes.
It was at that stage that the Supreme Court handed over several major cases, about nine of them, to SIT. That's when they created this SIT. Mm-hmm. And one such case was Naroda Patya, another was Naroda Gam. Now, when they were looking at this, it was only in 2008 that they started examining these two
called data records.
These two people.
Jaideep Patel and okay.
They were called. And it was found that there was a very significant discrepancy between what the call data record tells us about them and about what they were claiming in their testimony. They were denying that they were anywhere near Naroda Patya or Naroda Gam in those trouble spots. They were saying that they were not there in that at that time when the violence was going on. But the call data record suggests something else, that that in the morning, you know, before the violence began, there was these movements. So, and then not just movements, but also these calls that they were making. All these things were coming out of that. So because of these very serious discrepancies, it was incumbent on the SIT to take action against them. But then they were going soft on these two because of their political clout. And remember, in 2007, after Modi won the elections of 2007, it was at that stage that he elevated this MLA to a minister. She was made a minister of women and child development. So she was part of his government. So they were dragging their feet. And in January, instead of, any police force in their place would have done, they should have straight away arrested her. Instead, they gave a notice to her to come and appear before them. Although they had already interrogated her, recorded her statement, but they adopted that same method. And that gave her time to flee.
Yeah.
So we had this odd sight of a minister going underground and her seeking bail.
This was all 2009 now,
2009,
right?
2009, early 2009.
Correct.
January they initiate that process.
Yes.
So in January she succeeds in getting an anticipatory bail, right, from a subordinate court. So then these people go to a high court. Then both of them were acting in tandem. Maya Kodnani and Jaideep Patel, right? It's another matter that subsequently, when the investigation was completed by the SIT and the charge sheets were filed, they implicated Jaideep Patel only in the Naroda Gam case and not in the Naroda Patya case. Hence the significance of Naroda Gam,
okay,
because he was not there, he did not figure in Naroda Patya. So Naroda Gam is the only one which will get, which will establish this man's complicity, if at all. Right, so
and the fact that Jaideep Patel, that there are call records which show him in touch with the Sanjay Balsawa,
Bhavsar,
who worked in Mr. Modi's office when he was chief minister, creates a different kind of
dynamic. He also testified before the SIT because all this was a matter of record. They had to investigate all these leads.
Right.
So he was also there on record, and so it was. Only when they appealed against anticipatory bail before the High Court did they succeed in getting it cancelled. And it was at that stage that this woman had to come over ground, quit the government, quit as minister.
Yeah.
And that was when these two leaders, together were arrested.
Right.
Maya Kodnani, okay. And so Jaideep Patel. So the link between them was there all through.
Correct.
Right. And now that if you have a case where eyewitnesses are testifying against her, as they did in the case of Naroda Patia, and if on that basis she is convicted here as well, and if on the basis of that kind of evidence,
Jaideep Patel
is also convicted, so it will be a very huge step forward.
Right.
So it's when you see it from Jaideep Patel's angle, this case assumes greater
right.
significance.
Right.
That's the point.
So in some ways, Maya Kodnani is a secondary player, as you're saying.
Well,
in terms of the significance of the case.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, what is equally significant in Maya Kodnani's matter would be the fact that while all this drama was going on in the very, you know, protracted trial in the Naroda Gam case, which,
yeah.
as you said, is a smaller case,
yeah.
actually, the appeal proceedings in the Naroda Patia case have reached a very advanced stage. In fact, the
judgment is reserved. In fact,
yeah,
it's
the arguments. The arguments are over.
Right.
The judgment is reserved. So, on the face of it, whatever this man said, strictly speaking, should not make any difference to the Naroda
Patia
appeal case,
okay.
nor even the Naroda Patia case,
right.
because he did not say anything that deviates from what
yeah.
is already known.
Correct. Correct.
What is already
established. And her conviction in Naroda Patia is a product of many other factors and
yeah. so if
bits
she,
of evidence.
If she still thought that it would make a big difference to her case, if she, it was at her initiative that at this belated stage, this man who meanwhile became
the
yeah. second most important political leader
right.
in the country,
right.
right? If he was brought into this case as a witness, it was purely at her instance.
Mm.
So she probably calculated the optics of it.
Yeah.
That if he says something
mm.
that will play a major role, it will influence the mind of the court. But on the face of it, it should not,
yeah.
because
right.
he didn't say anything that was not already known.
Correct.
And it does not detract from anything that the eyewitnesses said.
Yeah.
So
perhaps she's hoping that even the High Court will be influenced in some way
yeah,
by even though it has no locus at all.
That's
to,
clear,
yeah,
that
yeah.
clearly seems to be her calculation
yeah,
because
yeah.
he didn't say anything that
should
serve as
that's
an alibi
right,
to
that's
her
right, that's right.
or that should help her in any.
That's right. And it's interesting that during the Naroda Patia trial itself.
Mm.
She made no effort to get Amit Shah to testify as a
yeah.
defense witness.
Yeah. This was just one very, after the desperate move on her
yeah,
part
yeah.
while she's dealing
yeah,
with
yeah,
this.
Yeah, yeah.
And she's also hoping to take advantage of the environment that is
correct.
There now.
I mean, if
post 2014, when there has been a spate of reversals
yeah.
in many Gujarat riot cases and fake encounter cases
correct,
Hindu terror
yeah,
cases.
Yeah, yeah.
So she's hoping to get advantage from that.
So if one were to be cynical but also
mm.
factual,
mm.
she perhaps decided not to call Amit Shah during the trial stage of Naroda Patia because at that point Amit Shah himself was an accused person,
yeah?
right?
Yeah.
He was charged with the involvement in the murder of Kausarbi,
yeah.
Sorabuddin, later Tulsiram Prajapati.
And he was
externed from
Gujarat. As they say, Tadipar he was.
Wouldn't so exactly have been the best character witness
yeah,
at that stage, but
exactly.
now that he has managed to get discharged from the
Kausarbi
and Prajapati and Sorabuddin cases and is now BJP president.
Absolutely.
This kind of thing has an entirely different.
Siddharth, you hit the nail on the head.
Yeah.
I mean, from the evidence point of view, her move to call this man has no great significance. From a political point of view, yeah, probably.
Right.
She's hoping that it will influence the
right.
outcome of the judgment
right.
on the basis of these extraneous considerations.
Right. Right.
We
okay.
can only hope
right.
that
right.
the judge concerned
right.
will not
right.
Be swayed by
correct.
Such considerations
correct.
And will go
yeah.
strictly on the
yeah.
basis of merits, as did the judge dealing
okay.
with the Naroda
yeah.
Patia case.
I think we've dealt with these two cases quite comprehensively, but I do want to take advantage for a few minutes because apart from being an expert on the 2002 killings, you are also somebody who has studied the 84 massacres or genocide extensively, and you've written about the legal cases. When you said Kodnani was the first politician to be convicted for involvement in a communal massacre case, she isn't, of course, the first politician to be suspected of playing a role.
Yeah.
We saw, very, very credible allegations and lots of eyewitness accounts that identified HKL Bhagat, Sajjan Kumar, Jagdish Taitler, etc. during the 84 massacres. None of those cases reached fruition, but you do believe that in at least one of those cases currently involving Sajjan Kumar, there is a possibility that different kind of outcome may come?
Since you drew this parallel, I'm happy to point out that, another reason why her presence in these two places is not going to count for much is because the allegation against her is of conspiracy.
Correct.
So the conspirator doesn't necessarily have to
be physically present.
Physically present there, because it's nobody's case, it is nobody's allegation that she personally killed anybody. The allegation is that she was there at some point in the morning to instigate and to supply arms and so on, right? Now, in the case of 84, there were such allegations against HKL Bhagat. Now, the reason I'm comparing her to Bhagat is because Bhagat happened to be from the constituency which was the worst hit,
East Delhi. Yeah.
Trilokpuri is in East Delhi, right? Now, it was nobody's allegation that he was himself there on the streets leading the mob or, being part of the mob that killed anybody, right? But significantly, in the case of Sajjan Kumar, who was the MP of an even larger constituency, Outer Delhi, such allegations were made extensively. Sultanpuri, Mangolpuri, Delhi Cant, these are all outlying areas of Delhi. There, witness after witness would say, this man who was much younger, who was part of that Sanjay Gandhi brigade,
right?
So he was physically there leading the mobs. There were lots of eyewitnesses, right? So I find it significant that this the allegations against her fall somewhere in between,
right?
Because she was there on the spot,
right?
But like in Bhagat's case, she wasn't herself leading the mobs, the allegations against Sajjan Kumar are further,
correct,
that he was leading the mobs.
Correct. Correct.
In spite of that kind of evidence, there were some cases in which he got acquitted. But there was one, the last such case is pending right now before the High Court. In fact, those of us who studied that case, lawyers like H.S. Fulka, my co-author of the book, were all very confident that this is a clear case of conviction. Yet, on some technicalities, on the basis that is very questionable, the trial court acquitted this man. But fortunately, it is now, the appeal is pending before a very upright judge, Justice Geeta Mittal, who has taken this seriously enough to be hearing this appeal on a regular basis. Twice every week she's hearing it. And she's asking the right kind of questions, and the parties, the defense counsel, are finding it very hard. We have a very good lawyer representing the CBI, who's Mr. Chima, who's been doing playing a stellar role in placing evidence on record. So we are hoping that for the first time in 3 decades, the Kodnani precedent of being convicted in the Naroda Patia case, we might see such a thing happening in Delhi. If it happens, it will be a huge fillip to the rule of law, and it will be a huge dent in this issue of impunity for communal violence.
Manoj, we'll have to leave it there, and thank you very much for sharing your expertise on this topic. Before we go, we've seen, whether it's 84 or 2002, whether it's Maya Kodnani or Sajjan Kumar or any other politician, politicians may differ in terms of their ideology or political views, but they can and are often partners in crime when it comes to genocide or massacres of the sort that we've seen in these two situations and in others. The struggle for justice, whether for the 84 victims or for the 2002 victims, has been long and difficult. But in the case of Naroda Patia, presumably and hopefully in the case of Naroda Gam, and in the case of the Delhi Cant trial appeal, where politicians whose role has long been suspected, justice may finally be done. Thank you very much for watching, and do join us again. Visit thewire.in for more details and plenty of background material on both the 2002 massacres and the 1984 genocide.